the NewsHour tonight, the trial intensifies. The Minneapolis chief of police testifies against former officer Derek Chauvin, who's charged with murder in the death of George Floyd. Then, on the front lines, more hospitals struggle with a dramatic rise in new COVID infections, raising concerns about widespread efforts to reopen public spaces. And decriminalizing drugs, Oregon becomes the first state to reduce penalties for possession and use of hard substances, focusing instead on treatment.
So let's try a different way than putting people in jail, taking away their ability to get a job, taking away relationships, their housing, the very things that we know support either long-term recovery or substance use with less harm.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Before we talk about your investments, what's new?
Well, Audrey's expecting.
Twins.
Grandparents.
We want to put money aside for them, so change in plans.
All right, let's see what we can adjust.
We'd be closer to the twins.
Change in plans.
Okay.
Mom, are you painting again? You could sell these.
Let me guess, change in plans?
At Fidelity, a change in plans is always part of the plan.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org. The Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. Working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone. At CZI.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Stephanie Tsai at NewsHour West. We'll return to Judy Woodruff and the full program after the latest headlines. A possible path has opened for Democrats to pass President Biden's massive infrastructure plan with only 50 votes. That's after the Senate parliamentarian who advises on rules for the U.S. Senate weighed in. It's unclear whether Democrats will take that route or continue to try and win some Republican support. Earlier today, President Biden again touted the $2.3 trillion infrastructure package. The president spoke to reporters outside the White House.
We're talking about making sure you're in a situation where we can redo some of the federal buildings that are just absolutely leaking energy every single day. That's infrastructure, in addition to roads and bridges and highways and broadband. So it's interesting how their definition of infrastructure has changed. But they know we need it.
Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell said the president's plan is, quote, something we're not going to do, and he argued increasing taxes to pay for it would only hurt the economy even more. McConnell spoke at a vaccination clinic in Lexington, Kentucky.
Enough is enough. We're threatening the future of our country. So it would have to be completely recrafted in a way that was not going to engage in undoing the tax increase, have it credibly paid for without running up even more of the debt.
President Biden's proposal would increase the current corporate tax rate from 21% to 28%, impacting primarily big businesses. The nation's inoculation campaign against COVID-19 is gaining ground. An average of 3.1 million shots were administered daily over the past week, peaking at a record 4 million on Saturday. Health officials said that's leading to a steady drop in deaths among older Americans, but COVID infections are on the rise among young people.
Cases are increasing nationally, and we are seeing this occur predominantly in younger adults. This is why you've heard me so clearly share my concern. We are learning that many outbreaks in young people are related to youth sports and extracurricular activities. According to CDC guidance, these activities should be limited.
We'll have more on the uptick in cases later in the program. Meanwhile, Florida and Maryland became the latest states to open vaccine eligibility for all adults. And overseas, daily virus infections in India surpassed 100,000 for the first time, making it the second country after the U.S. to reach that benchmark. The U.S. Supreme Court handed Google a victory today in a copyright dispute with software developer Oracle. It centered around thousands of lines of code that Google copied from Oracle's Java platform to build its popular Android operating system. In a 6-2 opinion, the justices ruled that constituted a fair use. Justice Amy Coney Barrett wasn't confirmed when the case was argued and did not participate. Crews near Tampa Bay, Florida, are scrambling to drain a wastewater pond that is near collapse. At least 30 people have been evacuated. The initial leak at the Piney Point Reservoir was discovered last week, but a drone has now detected a possible second breach. Manatee County officials were optimistic that new pumps could drain the 480 million gallon pond before disaster strikes.
If we go from 35 million gallons a day to 100 million gallons a day or more pulling it out, you can see how within probably 48 hours, if all those flows continue, we will be at a situation where we will no longer have that risk of that full breach, which would send that 20-foot wall of water across.
Officials said the situation posed a major flood risk, but was not a threat to local drinking water. Damage from a powerful tropical cyclone is hindering rescue efforts across Southeast Asia today. The storm has claimed the lives of at least 133 people in Indonesia and East Timor. Heavy rains triggered landslides and flash floods, which uprooted trees and destroyed homes. Thousands of people were displaced.
Everything is gone. We only managed to salvage whatever we could save. Compared to the possessions, our lives are more important. If we save the items, we might die. It's better we save ourselves.
The storm is expected to linger a few more days before moving toward Australia. Renewed tribal fighting in Sudan has left at least 40 people dead over the past 3 days. The clashes broke out in the western Darfur region this weekend between Arab and non-Arab groups. Similar violence earlier this year killed nearly 500 people, challenging efforts by Sudan's transitional government to restore peace. Back in this country, the governor of Arkansas vetoed a bill that would have made his state the first to ban gender-affirming care for transgender youth. The bill barred doctors from providing puberty blockers, hormones, and surgery to minors. Republican Asa Hutchinson rejected the measure at the urging of doctors and parents, but a simple majority of the state legislature can override the veto. And the Stanford women's basketball team is celebrating its first NCAA championship victory in nearly 30 years. They defeated Arizona last night in a squeaker, 54-53. In the game's final moments, Arizona missed a long shot before the buzzer to hand Stanford its third national title. Still to come on the NewsHour with Judy Woodruff, the Minneapolis police chief testifies against former officer Derek Chauvin. Hospitals struggle with a dramatic rise in new COVID infections. A Jordanian prince is accused of plotting a coup against the king, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Good evening. As you can see, I'm back in our NewsHour studio again. Life is not back to normal, but we're taking small steps to see what works. I am so grateful to our staff for working both here and from home and for doing all we can to stay safe. And we appreciate your staying with us for the news. In the Derek Chauvin trial today, the prosecution examines the former Minneapolis police officer's use of force and whether kneeling on Mr. Floyd's neck for more than 9 minutes violated protocol. Special correspondent Fred DeSam-Lazaro reports, and a note, this report contains disturbing images from Mr. Floyd's death that were shown during testimony.
Do you swear or affirm?
During the sixth day of testimony in the Derek Chauvin trial, prosecutors called Minneapolis Police Chief Madaria Arredondo to the stand.
Up until May 26, 2020, an individual named Derek Chauvin was a Minneapolis police officer, is that right?
That is correct.
The city's top cop, who fired Chauvin after the death of George Floyd, is the first African-American to hold the position. Chief Arredondo spoke to alternative methods Minneapolis police officers are trained in, including de-escalation.
De-escalation is providing a knowledge base or skills, in this case for officers, to really focus on time, options, and resources. It's really primarily trying to provide an opportunity to stabilize a situation, to de-escalate it, and with the goal is having a safe and peaceful outcome.
Minneapolis Police Department also has a professional policing policy, is that right?
Yes, it's really about treating people with dignity and respect. Above all else, at the highest level.
Arredondo recalled reviewing footage of the incident soon after learning that Mr. Floyd had been transported via ambulance.
Do you believe that the defendant followed departmental policy?
I absolutely do not agree with that.
Do you have a belief as to when this restraint, the restraint on the ground that you viewed, should have stopped?
Once Mr. Floyd had stopped resisting, and certainly once he was in distress and trying to verbalize that, that should have stopped. There's an initial reasonableness in trying to just get him under control in the first few seconds, but once there was no longer any resistance, and clearly when Mr. Floyd was no longer responsive and even motionless, to continue to apply that level of force to a person proned out, handcuffed behind their back, that in no way, shape, or form is anything that is by policy, it is not part of our training, and it is certainly not part of our ethics or our values.
Also on the stand today, Dr. Bradford Wankedi Langenfelt, the emergency room physician who pronounced George Floyd dead. Dr. Wankedi Langenfelt said Mr. Floyd had been in cardiac arrest for 60 minutes before he called his time of death.
Was your leading theory then for the cause of Mr. Floyd's cardiac arrest oxygen deficiency?
That was one of the more likely possibilities. I felt that at the time, based on the information I had, it was more likely than the other possibilities.
The cause of Floyd's death is a key argument in the case, with prosecutors saying that oxygen deprivation was caused by Chauvin's actions. Defense attorney Eric Nelson has argued that a drug overdose, along with an underlying heart condition, were responsible. For the PBS NewsHour, this is Fred DeSam-Lazaro.
Let's talk more now about what we heard from Police Chief Arredondo today and the wider reaction to the testimony so far. Uzodima Frank Abaonu is a civil attorney and president of the Minnesota Association of Black Lawyers, and he has been following the trial closely. Mr. Abaonu, thank you very much for joining us. First of all, tell us what your reaction has been today to hearing from the police chief, Mr. Arredondo.
Thank you for having me. And I think today is one of those days where it kind of comes full circle in a little bit because, you know, Special Prosecutor Jerry Blackwell said he's going to provide us a bouquet of humanity and show us people who witnessed this accident, this murder. And you have the chief, who is, like the defense attorney said, the general of the Minneapolis Police Department, the top and the head, who's speaking out about what he saw and said that there's no way that what happened was by policy, design, good policing, any of that. And I think for BIPOC community, for people here in Minneapolis, to see the chief of police say that, it's just something that really expresses how wrong what happened in May of 2020.
And what's the significance that this is coming from the chief of police? I mean, how unusual is it for someone in his position to be testifying against one of his own, in this case, former officers?
Highly unusual. And when we think about this, having him testify really speaks to this community. You heard the chief. He's from Minneapolis. You know, he was born and raised here. And he rose up from the ranks, and now he is chief. So he speaks not only to the Minneapolis community as a whole, the Minnesota community as a whole, but the Black community here in Minneapolis and Minnesota and in the world around. So having someone of his ranking status speak out, again, I my words would not do it justice.
What you mentioned, the Black community, the community of people of color there, what are you hearing? What are the kinds of reactions are you hearing from the community to the trial so far, including some of the very emotional testimony we heard last week?
You know, I think it's twofold, right? You have people expressing thanks for that, that the trial is open, right? It's televised, but not many people understood what a criminal trial would look like. And so this is eye-opening to see the process, to see the detail, the care, and the advocacy that the prosecution is showing. But also, especially with the testimony last week, you know, we had children, you know, we had older individuals, we had white people, Black people, everyone speaking up from their hearts, and the courage that it took for them to stand up and to say it to the officers at the time, but also come to the trial. And for us to listen to that and to revisit that trauma, you know, it's powerful in so many respects. And I think it just speaks volumes to the people we have in the city.
And you mentioned trauma. I mean, talk about what that means, Mr. Abaonu, to hear this. Essentially, we've heard a death described over and over again from multiple people who were there when it took place.
You know, seeing this in May 2020, and you know, me and my wife, we live in South Minneapolis, 20 or so blocks away from this. So this is our home. And seeing that video and just seeing the reaction you had of the world, not just Black and brown people, but the world. And now we're revisiting that. And so for Black and brown people, seeing that, I will call it torture of an individual for 9 minutes and 29 seconds, I can't imagine what Mr. Floyd's family's feeling, let alone the witnesses who testified and relived that trauma. Because for me watching that, it was painful because I had revisited over and over again. But it's necessary. It's necessary for us to get justice, but it doesn't stop it from being any less painful.
And is it fair to say the community is coming together in a way over this, or essentially holding their breath to see what the outcome of this trial is?
I think a bit of both. Honestly, I think that having the wide variety of individuals who have testified so far shows that there's a lot of support for the prosecution in this case. But, you know, I wouldn't lie to you to say that this has happened to Black folks over and over again. And we've asked that there be some justice and some change. And we haven't really gotten that in a lot of circumstances. So there are people holding their breath and hoping that justice will be served in this instance. And this is the arena. This is a chance for that to happen. But I among others, would probably say, I'm waiting for the day when the jury tells us their decision, because you just never know. But I'm hoping, based on what we've seen, that we do touch people and they understand that this was murder.
Frank Abaonu, who is president of the Minnesota Association of Black Lawyers, we thank you very much.
Thank you.
even as vaccinations are rising substantially in this country, parts of the U.S., particularly in the upper Midwest and the Northeast, are now seeing a surge in COVID cases. Michigan is struggling with an especially strong spike. William Brangham has an update about what's happening there.
Judy, if you were to look at a line on a graph of new cases in Michigan, it's been curving higher and higher since early March and then worsening over the past 2 weeks. The state is averaging more than 6,400 new cases a day over the last week. Hospitalizations are rising as well. And a data analysis by the New York Times finds the six worst metro areas in the country with new outbreaks relative to their population are all in Michigan. Dr. Nick Gilpin has been deeply involved in dealing with all of this. He's the medical director of infection prevention and epidemiology at the Beaumont Health System, and he joins me now. Dr. Gilpin, thanks for taking the time to talk with us. Obviously, you're quite swamped in what you're dealing with right now. Can you just give us a sense of what you're seeing in your hospitals?
Yeah, happy to. Well, we are certainly swamped. That's probably an understatement, frankly. This is, I would say, our third surge of COVID that we've experienced in the last year. Our first and by far mightiest surge was back in March and April of 2020. We had a bit of a respite in the summertime. And then we experienced our second big surge in the fall and winter. And then we had another brief respite in the later part of January and February. And then that's culminated in this familiar drumbeat of cases, hospitalizations, and test positivity rates rising at really an unprecedented rate. When we look back at activity that we've experienced in the past, the slope of this line is alarming, to say the least.
And you told one of my colleagues that you're seeing test positivity rates in the 15 to 20% range, which is a lot of virus circulating in your community. Do you have a sense of what is driving those high rates?
I do. I think for starters, what we're seeing right now in terms of these astronomically high positivity rates is this is all kind of come on the tails of a relaxation in restrictions. So for the better part of the winter and after the holidays, bars and restaurants were predominantly closed, mass gatherings were discouraged, and then as case numbers started to decline, a lot of those restrictions were relaxed. So I think what you're seeing is a lot of people who are frankly tired of COVID. They want to get together, they want to see their family, they're starting to get vaccinated. And so there's this sense of people getting together more in the community. That's one half of the equation. I think the other half of the equation is we're seeing a lot more of these COVID variants, specifically the B.1.1.7 or the UK variant, which is absolutely in our backyard right now in Michigan. I believe we're the second highest state in terms of B.1.1.7. And we know that the B.1.1.7 variant is not only more transmissible, but also potentially more deadly as well. So you put those two things together, relaxed restrictions and a B.1.1.7 more transmissible variant, and I think that accounts for why you're seeing so many cases.
And you were saying before that hospitalizations have been going up, but are you seeing a similar rise in the deaths, or are we still doing a pretty good job of keeping those people alive?
Yeah, great question. Not yet. I think what I'm seeing right now is an overall rise in the number of hospitalizations, a slightly younger demographic of patients, which when you think about it, makes sense because we're doing a very good job of vaccinating older individuals. So we're driving that vulnerable population down to a younger age. So instead of seeing predominantly 60-somethings, now we're seeing more 50-somethings and even some 40-somethings. And that's really what we're seeing the most of in our hospitals right now. With regard to how sick these patients are, it's a little too early to say for sure, but the early trends are favorable. These patients don't appear to be as sick. They don't seem to be quite as intensive in terms of the resources that they require. We're not seeing a lot of ventilator use, a lot of ICU utilization. But again, it's very early still.
I mean, this has got to be so incredibly frustrating for you because, as you're saying, you're doing a pretty good job as a state in vaccinating enough people, and yet now these variants that have snuck in are seeming to threaten that real miraculous progress that we're making.
100%. And I think the takeaway here that I would like to offer to folks is getting vaccinated is great, and I'm glad that we're doing so well at that, but it's not the end-all be-all to stopping COVID transmission. I think we have to continue to be diligent. We have to continue to wear our masks and do our physical distancing. We got to do everything we can as a community to stop transmission. There's fundamentally, as a hospital, there's very little that I can do to stop transmission from happening in the community.
Dr. Nick Gilpin of Beaumont Health Systems in Michigan, thanks very much for being here, and best of luck to you dealing with what you're dealing with.
Thank you.
Palace intrigue shakes one of the Middle East's most historically stable monarchies. Jordan's King Abdullah is challenged by the former crown prince, his half-brother Hamza. As Nick Schifrin tells us, there are long simmering reasons for the confrontation.
In Jordan this weekend, a simmering family feud publicly boiled over.
Lives and futures of our children and their children are at stake if this continues.
When popular Prince Hamza accused his half-brother's government of neglecting its own people.
Their well-being has been put second by a ruling system that has decided that its personal interests, that its financial interests, that its corruption is more important than the lives and dignity and futures of the 10 million people that live here.
Jordanian authorities placed Hamza under house arrest for what they labeled an attempt to unseat his half-brother, King Abdullah. They arrested nearly 20 other people for collaboration, including former finance minister Basim Awadallah, in what Jordan's foreign minister called a foreign-backed plot.
These investigations also found links between Basim Awadallah and foreign elements, the so-called external opposition, related to weakening Jordan's steadfast position on major issues.
For decades, Jordan was ruled by King Hussein. His second wife, Princess Muna al-Hussein, gave birth to their oldest son, Abdullah, the current king, who took power in 1999. Hussein's fourth wife, Noor, a Syrian-American, gave birth to Hamza, making Hamza Abdullah's half-brother. The Hashemite kingdom has long been viewed as a reliable partner at a crossroads in the Middle East, bordering Syria, Iraq, Israel, and the occupied West Bank. But its economy is struggling. This year, unemployment jumped to 25%. Exports and tourism are down. Syrian refugees tax an overburdened system. And the downturn's exacerbated by one of the world's strictest COVID lockdowns.
Our economy is collapsing. Look at the shop. It is empty.
That frustration has fueled protests. Last month, security forces fired tear gas at anti-lockdown demonstrators. And last year, King Abdullah dissolved the country's parliament. But Hamza's criticism is unique because its source and target are the highest echelons of royal power.
This country has become stymied in corruption, in nepotism, and in misrule. And the result has been the destruction or the loss of hope.
Jordan's allies quickly came to the kingdom's defense.
The king has our full support, and that is in large part because Jordan is a close friend.
And a Saudi royal court statement affirmed its full standing by and the support with all its capabilities for the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan. But internally, Hamza's defenders defied the government. His mother, Noor, tweeted, "Truth and justice will prevail for all the innocent victims of this wicked slander." Today, at first, Hamza vowed to keep speaking out.
Of course I will not abide when he tells me, you are not allowed to go out, tweet, or connect with people, and you are only allowed to see family members.
But by the end of the day, he released a statement, quote, "We must all stand behind His Majesty the King."
We explore this rift now with Dr. Besma Momani, professor of political science at the University of Waterloo in Ontario, Canada. Thank you very much. Welcome to the NewsHour. So Jordan's allies have always viewed it as an oasis of stability. Do these incidents affect that stability?
Well, certainly it suggests that there's some sort of cracks inside the system. And Jordanians have been really perplexed by the narrative that the government has given them. It's unclear whether or not there is some sort of foreign element to the story, or is this an internal squabble within the royal family? That's really the main question. And certainly, I think many Jordanians could deal with the reality that there might be internal squabbles. But the idea that there is some sort of foreign meddling or intervention or possible plot to undermine the government is something that is clearly keeping them up awake tonight.
There's no proof that authorities have presented of the foreign plot, and there's certainly talk of this family feud, which has existed in the past. What is the source of that family feud, and how long has it been running?
There's certainly some regular kinds of succession battles that one sees in royal families. But, you know, I think unlike what you might see in neighboring countries, whether it's, Saudi Arabia or the UAE and others, we haven't seen this kind of very public display of challenges from within. And that really is quite remarkable. Now, Prince Hamza is a popular figure, and certainly amongst a certain group, particularly East Bank tribal community, which do see that he really is reminiscent of his father. In many ways, he has the same kind of charismatic personal touch. Even if you saw in the video, there was, I think, a lot of references to the common person, the struggles of corruption, the economic crisis that is really on the minds of many Jordanians. So, you know, he is very much in the spotlight. And I think that really is one of the core issues that, in fact, led to this situation that the country's in today.
Does that popularity among tribal leaders that Prince Hamza had, does that translate into actual power that would allow him to actually threaten the government?
No, I don't think so, partly because these East Bank tribes very much don't want to see the monarchy as an institution crumble. They're disaffected. Certainly, they do feel that there needs to be some serious structural reforms in the country. They're very frustrated with the nepotism and the corruption. But in no way do I think they have any interest in seeing undermining of the regime. And regardless, I think bringing in a different king, for that matter, would just bring in that kind of instability that no Jordanian, including East Bankers, wants to see. But what you did see in the past few days is, in fact, many Jordanians changing their avatars, if you will, to the picture of Hamza, a lot of outpouring of support on Facebook, questioning the narrative that the government gave them. And I think actually we saw in many ways the royal palace today kind of concede to the fact that this is not working. This messaging backfired. The release of that tape that Hamza sent out was making the situation more problematic, and they were better off to actually make amends. And that's exactly what we saw today.
Finally, let's talk quickly about some of the other people arrested. Basim Awadallah, who was an informal liaison of the king to Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. What's the significance of his arrest?
Well, I think, frankly, it was an attempt of distraction, trying to put a foreign element into this. Look, Basim Awadallah has no popularity inside the country. He's been, frankly, blamed for a lot of the privatization, neoliberal policies that have made so many things difficult for the average Jordanian. So his name is synonymous with so much of the things and the economic policies in particular that the country does not like and feels very much challenged the way that Jordan had its social contract for so many years. So I think it really is a distraction. And the connection between Hamza and Basim Awadallah, I mean, I think there's no imaginative person who could make that connection. So really to try and find a way to lump these two together in one sentence just does not make sense. And frankly, it added more confusion and uncertainty in the narrative being provided by the government.
Professor Besma Momani, thank you very much.
Thank you, Nick.
Well, the times, they are a-changin'. With New York State's recent legalization of recreational cannabis, more than 40% of Americans now live in states that have embraced marijuana legalization. Oregon has been on the leading edge of drug law reform, and in November became the first to decriminalize possession of hard drugs. As other states eye similar moves, Stephanie Tsai reports on Oregon's early rollout and the obstacles ahead.
37-year-old Sabrina Brandt has been an IV drug user since she was 16.
I had mental health issues and since age 12 have been on multiple antidepressants and have multiple diagnoses. And so I think my IV drug use with heroin and cocaine was a way to self-medicate.
She describes her relationship with drugs as a love-hate thing.
I felt like if I quit using drugs, like right now, it'd be like losing my closest confidant, like my best friend, because he's been with me for so many years. So.
If Sabrina were caught with, say, less than a gram of heroin or 2 grams of meth in Oregon today, she'd receive no more than the equivalent of a parking ticket, with a maximum fine of $100. She could avoid paying that by making a phone call with a counselor for a health assessment. It's a sea change. Measure 110, which was passed by 58% of Oregon voters last November, treats active drug users as potential patients rather than criminals. Portland addiction specialist Dr. Andy Seaman says what they were doing wasn't working.
So let's try a different way than putting people in jail, taking away their ability to get a job, taking away relationships, their housing, the very things that we know support either long-term recovery or substance use with less harm.
Prior to Measure 110, in 2017, Oregon's legislature had already softened penalties on drug use, downgrading first-time possession of controlled substances to a misdemeanor, carrying a maximum sentence of a year. Measure 110 goes even further. Drug possession convictions are projected to plummet by 90%.
Measure 110 makes the business of dealing drugs much easier.
Since the measure was implemented in February, the district attorney of Benton County, John Haroldson, a critic of Measure 110, says he's already seen it abused.
I've already learned of an example of a dealer weaponizing Measure 110 to deal in quantities that are at the violation level and to carry the phone number so that if they get the citation, they just call and get the penalty waived.
What was he dealing?
Cocaine.
Haroldson favors the use of drug courts and mandated treatment.
There is accountability based upon the science around psychology and behavior. What motivates individuals to change, not just to alter what they're doing in the moment, but rather to really change and move into a life of recovery.
Andy Seaman disagrees.
Why mandated treatment doesn't work? Addiction is a complex neurobiological process that has a lot of social factors and relational factors, and people can't be told that they have to quit and be forced into it. It doesn't work that way.
For years, Oregon has had among the worst rates of substance use disorders and mental health conditions in the country, while ranking among the lowest for access to treatment services. Law enforcement officials throughout the state reported methamphetamines and heroin were readily available in their communities.
Drugs are in our community. They are already here.
Salem resident Christina Avery can personally attest to this. She became homeless after leaving an abusive relationship and got caught up in a cycle of drug use and jail.
It's just like constant, you know, and every jail trip is another charge and just that continuous cycle. And every time that I got out of jail, I was still homeless and I had been in the system many, many times. And I never got the support that I needed until I got pregnant. And I was way ready, you know, and willing previous to my pregnancy.
Go!
She says there need to be more humane options for users.
Look at you.
Measure 110 requires a fund be set up for addiction recovery centers and other services such as housing. At the state capitol, legislators are scrambling to implement all of this. And Representative Tana Sanchez says they are behind.
The sad reality is Oregon was already in almost last place for having access to resources for folks in who are trying to get clean and sober. So it just sort of made it really difficult to try to figure out how do we set all of that up when we're already in a deficit and we want to snap to and make that happen really, really quickly.
The measure funnels millions of dollars in marijuana tax revenue to the overall drug problem. But Sanchez says it takes funding from other needed services without a new revenue stream.
It essentially put a cap on the existing resources that went to cities and counties, to the state police, to the school fund.
So do you think the cart was put before the horse in a way?
This is a cart before the horse situation.
Andy Seaman says it may take time to stand up all the services, but it is the right direction.
Anytime there's a transformational change, people are always going to say it's not time yet and we need to do all of these things first. That's been the conversation for the last 50 years.
On Wednesdays, Sabrina Brandt volunteers at the Portland People's Outreach Project, a harm reduction organization that provides clean syringes, naloxone to reverse overdoses, and strips to test for the deadly synthetic opioid fentanyl, which increases the risk of overdosing.
The more people that have it, the less people that are going to die, you know?
Measure 110 puts a focus on this type of intervention. And with overdose deaths spiking 40% in Oregon during the pandemic, it's never been more needed.
You can't make somebody stop using drugs that doesn't want to stop using drugs. But you can cut down on the amount of harm they do to themselves and society by offering them different tools.
Like Brandt, not everyone will choose the path of sobriety. But Christina Avery did. She hasn't done drugs for more than 3 years.
Once I tapped into the support, once I accepted what it is that I had to do or was required to do, my life changed dramatically. Oh my God, everything.
Other states trying to find a way out of the failed war on drugs have their eyes on Oregon. It's an experiment where the stakes could hardly be higher. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai.
The backlash to Georgia's new voting laws is forcing companies to decide if they do business in the state. Here to analyze the political calculations behind the pressure and the response, our Politics Monday team, Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and Tamara Keith of NPR. Hello to both of you. So good to see you on this Monday. Amy, I'm going to start with you and the Georgia law. The reverberations continue. A number of companies taking a stand, Coca-Cola, Delta Airlines, prominent black leaders taking a stand against. And then over the weekend or Friday, Major League Baseball pulling out the All-Star game from Atlanta. My question is, how does this kind of pressure sit with political leaders? Can it be effective in getting them to change a law?
Yeah, you know, Judy, this is really fascinating. Actually, it's been a fascinating development that's been going on for the last 10 or 15 years. It didn't really start with this Georgia law. We saw it, for example, in places like North Carolina with the bathroom bill. We've seen it on gay rights in other states, gun laws in other states. Really what's happening, and this is especially true in the South, these metro regions like Atlanta, like Dallas, like Houston, that used to be pretty Republican, have now become much more Democratic, much more blue, and in some cases, deep blue. And this is where these companies are headquartered. And many of their employees, they come from those blue areas. They live in those blue areas. And their expectations are that the companies that they work for reflect the values that they share. And that's, I think, a big reason why we're seeing so many of these companies in states where the company has an incredible influence, but where that influence is really relegated to just the metro region. And so, unfortunately, Judy, what I think happens is it divides the state once again between those who live in and around that big metro area who say, absolutely, we support this, and those who live outside of it who believe that their values and views aren't being taken into consideration. And, you know, I think for so many voters, they're left then forced to pick a side. Do I choose the place where I live right now? And in some cases, you're having companies that are agreeing much more with what's going on in other states than what's going on in their own.
And so, Tam, how do you see the political dynamics of this? How effective is it?
Well, and what I'll say is, as Amy was alluding to, Governor Kemp in Georgia came out swinging and called this cancel culture, which is becoming an increasingly common refrain from Republicans in recent months, especially. And what you do have here, though, is Major League Baseball Major League Baseball would not choose to do something unpopular broadly with the public. Major League Baseball, just like other companies who have made and taken stands, for instance, in North Carolina before several years ago, these companies are following public opinion. It may not be public opinion in the state where they're taking that action, but it is national public opinion. Companies do what is in their best commercial interest. And that is what we've been seeing play out again and again. And just one other example, as Amy alluded to, is what happened with Governor Kristi Noem in South Dakota vetoing a transgender sports bill, in part under pressure from the NCAA, which is hugely influential. When these major sporting institutions pull out of a place, as they did in Indianapolis, in Indiana several years ago, as the All-Star Game is happening with baseball, there are huge economic implications. But is this going to change the Georgia voting law? That's not clear. And also, the Georgia voting law is a bit more nuanced than the fight about it is now making it seem.
No question. And it's something I know that we continue to report on here. But you're right about the influence of athletics, of sports, and how that can cut across our cultural and our political world in so many different ways. The other thing I want to bring up with the two of you, though, Amy, a flashback to 2020 and campaign finance. The New York Times reporting over the weekend that the Trump campaign ended up having to refund $64 million in donations from people who were, in a way, misled by the way they were the money was being solicited. There was a line, I guess, early in the year when people were solicited saying, please sign up here for a recurring donation. But then as the year went on, the font was smaller and smaller. People didn't see what they were signing up for. And now the campaign is having to pay up. And by the way, the Biden camp being found guilty of the same thing, paying back, but a much smaller amount, just $6 million. But what does this say about our campaign finance system, that this is going on?
Yeah, it's a really interesting story. And I think it's something that, you know, in this era now of fundraising that is becoming where small dollar donors are becoming more and more dominant, that these stories may become more regular. Look, the Trump campaign depended much more on small donors than the Biden campaign did. And remember, at the very end of the summer, it became clear that even though the Trump campaign started out with this huge fundraising lead, they had squandered a lot of that money. They'd spend a lot of that money before they hit the fall, and they were desperate to raise a lot of money very quickly. That's hard to do when people are only writing you a $20 or $25 check at a time. You know, the good news about small dollar donors, Judy, is that it democratized the process, right? It brought regular people in. It's not just people with big bank accounts who can have these fancy dinners and invite politicians there. It's now regular people who can have influence. But that doesn't mean that it's not without some of its own drawbacks. And this is clearly one of them.
Tam?
Yeah, there is nothing like a bad fundraising number to make your money dry up, especially your big dollar money, because those big donors want to support a winner. They want something for their investment. And so what this story highlights is that, you know, after the election was over, all of these refunds go out. But at the time when they were hitting these big milestone donor amounts, donation amounts, it was based on a premise that involved a lot of people giving money they didn't know they were giving.
So much money washing around in our politics today. It's hard to even contemplate, even comprehend what it all is. But this story definitely caught our attention. Tamara Keith, Amy Walter, Politics Monday. Thank you both.
You're welcome.
As the economy slowly begins to pick up, many businesses are still facing a rocky year ahead. Special correspondent Kat Wise has a story about one family-owned business that has taken one hit after another, but is hanging on with support from the community.
Happy moments from a time before masks and social distancing at Enchanted Forest, a small amusement park nestled on a wooded hillside just south of Salem, Oregon. Normally this time of year, the park would be filled with spring breakers. But after an exceptionally turbulent year, capped by a devastating winter storm in February, this unique and much-loved park is closed and struggling to survive. Enchanted Forest was built by hand by this man.
I'm Roger Tofte, creator of Enchanted Forest.
Tofte, who recently turned 91, purchased the park's 20 acres in the early 1960s while working as a draftsman for the Oregon Highway Department. He spent 7 years during his free time building the park's storybook-themed attractions and brought them to life with his artist's eye. In August of 1971, he opened the park to the public.
When we started, we didn't have too much. We had the Seven Dwarfs Mine and the Witch and things like that. I think we charged 50 cents to go through.
Over the years, Tofte added to those attractions with the help of his four children and other family who now run the park. Around 100,000 visitors came each year, strolled through the quirky western town, got soaked on the log ride, and blasted evil characters in the Challenge of Mondor, which took Tofte 7 months to create. He took me for a spin on the ride during our recent visit.
Part of the ride is taking these blasters and aiming it at things?
Yes.
Okay.
They're infrared guns. We shoot at these blue spots.
We shoot at the blue spots. I think I got one.
Tofte's oldest daughter, Susan Vaslev, is co-manager of the park.
How would you sum up the past year?
Challenging. You know, I just keep thinking it's another challenge, it's another challenge, it's another challenge.
The first of those challenges, the pandemic.
Before COVID, we had no debt. We were a thriving family business. You know, things were great. Then we were forced to shut down. So we had zero income coming in. And an amusement park is very expensive to run.
Later in the summer, when government COVID regulations eased up, they were allowed to reopen, but at greatly reduced capacity. Then came the wildfires. As the Beachy Creek fire encroached on surrounding communities in early September, family members scrambled to save important documents and memorabilia, unsure if the park would survive. And nearby, a family tragedy unfolded. Roger Tofte's 13-year-old great-grandson, Wyatt Tofte, and his grandmother were killed by the fire outside their home. Wyatt's mother survived but was badly burned.
A horrible tragedy of trying to save Wyatt and Peggy and not being able to. The world could not have lost two more beautiful people, you know.
The Tofte family were hoping for a better year ahead, but damage from the ice storm set back their reopening plans.
Enchanted Forest is one of many small businesses around the country that have been devastated by the pandemic and other events over the past year. Many have had to get creative in order to survive, and that's what's happened here too. The Tofte family has reached out to the community for support, and there has been a big effort to save this beloved park.
In October, Enchanted Forest started a GoFundMe campaign, which has now raised more than $400,000 from nearly 8,000 donors. Many have taken to social media to express what the park has meant to them and their families. That money, combined with other fundraising efforts like a new Buy a Brick program and government COVID relief funds, have allowed the park to continue to operate, but just barely. Vaslev says they've had to let some staff go, and the park has taken on debt.
When you walk in, you just know that every piece was touched and made with love.
One of those rooting for the park is 23-year-old Selena Lopez Cruz, who worked at the park for 5 seasons and met her now husband there.
If Enchanted Forest were ever to go away, it's going to not be a loss to just me and my family, but it's going to be a loss to the whole community. It's just been a part of our community for such a long time.
There are so many similar institutions which are facing the same pressures.
University of Oregon history professor Vera Keller has been tracking what's been happening at Enchanted Forest and other cultural institutions across the state. She says if some don't make it, the impacts could be wide-ranging.
It's so important to our identity as Oregonians here in the state to have these places that we have had shared experiences in, like the Enchanted Forest. And it's around those places that we can come together, even when we disagree about, say, taxes or other political issues. There is an important social and cultural function that they serve.
Can you make it another year?
That's the big question. Until we are past the point where we have to social distance and sanitize between each rider, we cannot get back to normal.
For his part, Roger Tofte is optimistic about his park's future.
Yeah, Yeah, I'm pretty sure it'll survive.
Tofty and his family hope to reopen later in April. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Kat Wise in Turner, Oregon.
And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, Johnson & Johnson, BNSF Railway, the Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org.
The Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, driven by the promise of great ideas.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.